In this lecture, let us continue our angle modulation. So specifically, we are going to talk about properties of Bessel function. Okay, so we will continue our discussion on angle modulation. And if you recollect, we had looked at the spectrum of angle modulated signal when the modulating signal is a pure sinusoidal signal. That was the point at which we finished last time. So let me recapitulate. We wrote an expression for frequency modulated signal. X of t is equal to A times cosine of omega c t plus beta times sine omega m t. Okay, let me say this is equation number one. So we showed that this kind of angle modulated signal could be either an FM signal or an PM signal, phase modulated signal. So we could write this equation 1 in terms of series expansion, in which the coefficients of series are the Bessel functions. And the functions involved here are sinusoids of frequency omega c plus or minus n omega m, right, where n is equal to 0, 1, 2 and goes up to infinity. That means you get omega c, omega c plus omega m, omega c minus omega m, then omega c plus 2 omega m, then omega c minus 2 omega m, omega c plus 3 omega m, omega c minus 3 omega m, and so on so forth. Okay, so therefore your x of t can be written in terms of your series of expansion as A times cosine of omega c t plus A times sigma, let me say this is A c and this is A m, sigma, I'm sorry, let me put A, no problem, A times sigma n is equal to minus infinity to plus infinity j n of beta times cos of omega c plus n omega m times t. So that is the series expansion for the FM signal or the PM signal. This is series expansion for PM or FM signal. How did we arrive this? We arrived at this by considering the Fourier series expansion of e to the j times beta sine omega mt. Recall this from the previous lecture. Then considering the fact that the recorded signal is nothing but the real part of e to the j omega c times e to the j beta sine omega mt. So we expand e to the j beta sine omega mt into its Fourier series and then took the real part of that. That is what you get this expression. Now this is the starting point for our discussion regarding the spectrum of FM signal. Of course, please remember that we are doing the spectrum discussion. Okay, for the very special case when the modulating signal or message signal is AM times sine of omega MT. Okay, not for the general modulating signal M of T. That is a much more difficult exercise. Of course, the spectrum of FM signal is from this expression that we have a large number of frequency component, as I said. Okay, it goes up to infinity. Unlike the AM case where the frequency components are omega c, omega c plus omega m, and omega c minus omega m, these three constitutes your AM. And this all contains your FM. Therefore, your AM is a subset of FM. So you have a large number of frequency components present in the FM signal. And the behavior of the spectrum is dictated by the behavior of these coefficients, Jn of beta. Okay, this Jn of beta will dictate the, or will tell you the bandwidth of the FM signal or behavior of the spectrum. Therefore, the Bessel function controls the effect, the bandwidth of the signal. So to understand the spectrum better, you need to understand a little bit about the nature of the Bessel function. Okay, now this is not the course on mathematics, okay, so we will not study in detail about Bessel function. I will not really go into a mathematical discourse on Bessel functions. Rather, I will just give you a few salient features of Bessel function. Okay, and these features are relevant to our discussion, and I hope you learnt it in more detail from your math course. So let's now review some useful facts about Bessel functions. That's it. First, there is a kind of symmetry in these functions, okay, as a function on n. See, if you look at this expression, if you take this guy alone, sigma n is equal to minus infinity to plus infinity j n of beta cos of omega c plus n omega m t. Now you substitute 0, you will get j 0 of beta, and then substitute n equals 1 and minus 1, then you will get j 1 of beta and j 2 of beta, sorry, j minus 1 of beta, n is equal to 2 and minus 2, j 2 of beta and j minus 2 of beta. So in general, this j 1 of beta is equal to minus of j minus 1 of beta, and j 2 of beta will be equal to j suffix minus 2 of beta. Similarly, j 3 of beta is minus j minus 3 of beta. If the index is odd, then this minus sign will come. If index is even, then that will be equal. So in general, you can write, in general, this is the property of your Bessel function, okay? You can prove it mathematically, but we are not going to do in this course. J n of beta is equal to minus 1 whole to the power n j suffix minus n of beta. So this is the first property of your Bessel function. So in the series expansion, you have n going from minus infinity to plus infinity, and it can be shown that j n of beta is equal to minus 1 whole power n times j suffix minus n of beta. So this is how the Bessel functions with of order n and of order minus n are related. What it means is, this is equal to j n of beta is equal to j of minus n of beta for n is even, and maybe I can write like this: j n of beta is equal to j minus n of beta if n is even, and j n of beta is equal to minus of j suffix minus n of beta if n is odd. Okay, so alternate coefficients on the positive and negative side are symmetrical, okay, but positive sign. So j 1 of beta and j minus 1 of beta have opposite signs, okay, but j 2 of beta and j minus 2 of beta have the same sign, and so on so forth. So that is one interesting property of this Bessel functions. Now the second property is, this should be intuitively clear, but mathematically can also be proved, okay, that if you take square of each of these functions, you take j 0 squared, then j 1 squared, j minus 1 squared of beta, and so on, and add them up from minus infinity to plus infinity for any value of beta, then that should be equal to 1. So it says, you add all these guys, it should be equal to 1. Let us see. In the compact form, n is equal to minus infinity to plus infinity, j n squared of beta is equal to 1. So this is the second property. Okay, so it should not be obvious, but we can prove it actually. Let us take the expression. What is x of t? X of t is equal to a times cos of omega c t plus n times beta times sin n omega m t. Now what is the power in this signal? The power in this signal is a squared by 2, irrespective of whether you put a times cos omega c t or a times cos 100 omega c t or a times sin of 2000 omega c t, irrespective of the argument, this guy always has the power of a squared by 2. Okay, therefore the power in the signal is a squared by 2 in the modulator signal. Okay, it doesn't matter what beta you have and what have in the argument. Okay, now the same signal you can write in terms of a times sigma n is equal to minus infinity to plus infinity j n of beta times cos of omega c plus n omega m times t. Okay, now I want to find out the power for this guy. See, let's say this is equation 1 and let's say this is equation 2. In equation 1, what is the power? A square by 2. So in equation 2 also, because these both are equivalent, so in equation 2 also I must get the same power, a square by 2. Okay, then what can I do in this? Okay, now this must be equal to a square by 2. How can I do that? You take the a inside first. So this is sigma n is equal to minus infinity to plus infinity a times j n of beta times cos of omega c plus n omega m times t. Now what is the if you expand this, what will you get? Put n equals 0, a times j 0 of beta times cos omega c t, n equals minus 1, then a times j 1 of beta cos of omega c t plus omega m t. Substitute n equals minus 1, a times j of minus 1 cos of omega c minus omega m times t. Substitute n equals 2, a times j 2 of beta cos of omega c plus 2 omega m t. Substitute n equals minus 2, a times j suffix minus 2 of cos of omega c minus 2 omega m times t, plus keep on goes infinite number of terms. Now what is the power in this guy? The first component gives the power of a squared j naught squared of beta by 2, right? Now what is the power of the second component? This one, that is a squared j 1 squared of beta divided by 2. Recall this property. Okay, what I said, irrespective of the argument I have a squared by 2. Suppose if I have 5 times cos omega c t, my power is 5 times 5, 25, 25 by 2, right? In case a c times a m times cos of omega c plus omega m t, then what is the power? This power is equal to a c a m the whole squared by 2. That means this is equal to a c squared a m squared by 2, right? Similarly, here also you take the coefficient of the sinusoid. This is my sinusoid and this is the coefficient. Square of the coefficient divided by 2. From the third term, this is my coefficient, right? So a j minus 1 of beta, I forgot to put a beta here, divided by 2, square it and square it. A square j minus 1 square of beta divided by 2. and from this term you will get a squared j suffix 2 squared of beta by 2 plus a squared j minus 2 squared of beta plus 2 plus it keep on goes. Okay, so in this which is constant, a squared is constant and 2 is constant. Within the bracket you have j naught squared of beta plus j 1 squared of beta plus j suffix minus 1 squared of beta, right, plus j suffix 2 squared of beta plus j minus 2 of beta plus keep on goes. Now a squared by 2 and this in I can write in the summation form n is equal to minus infinity plus infinity j n square of beta. Now as per the given condition this must be equal to a square by 2 because this expression is the same as this expression. In this expression power is a square by 2, in this expression also a square by 2, so I got this a square by 2 here. Okay, the second expression also must give the power of a square by 2 because the second expression is the same as the first expression. So power will not change from one expression to another expression. After all, you are representing in terms of Fourier series, using a Fourier series. Okay, therefore the second expression also gives the power a square by 2. So this must be equal to a square by 2. When will it be equal to 2? When this is equal to 1. Therefore, this implies summation n is equal to minus infinity plus infinity j n squared of beta is equal to 1. So that's a proof of this. In fact, mathematically you can prove, but we proved using our thing. So total power must be the same, okay, whether you represent in equation 1 form, in this form, or whether you represent in this form. Okay, so that is the second property. Now let's move on to the third property. Thirdly, for beta, which is, do you remember what beta is? Beta is the index, modulation index. So if you remember this modulation index, we defined beta is equal to delta f by fm, or you can say beta is equal to 2 pi kf times am divided by omega m. In this case, what is delta f? Delta f is equal to kf times am. That's it. Either you can take this definition or this one, no problem. Okay, and this is for fm case. What is your beta fm? What is your beta pm? Beta pm is equal to kp times am. That's all. This is the modulation index for your phase modulator signal. But nevertheless, it is a factor, okay, which has some way important relevance to the present discussion, which will come to very soon. So we will call it a modulation index. Beta is a modulation index. When the modulation index is very small, let's say beta is much less than 1, then all the coefficients that we have are that we are referring to, the Bessel functions that we are referring to, have small arguments. Okay, if beta is very small, then what happens? J naught of beta, then j1 of beta, j suffix minus 1 of beta, j suffix 2 of beta, and so on. This is very small. If that is very small, then what will happen? Under these conditions, this j naught of beta is the predominant term. Compared to all other terms. Okay, therefore j naught of beta is the dominant term. So let me be more specific. Like if beta is much less than 1, then j naught of beta is approximately equal to 1. And j 1 of beta is approximately equal to beta by 2. And j n of beta is approximately equal to 0 for n is greater than 2. Okay, so this is the third property. So the third property is when beta is less than 1, J naught of beta dominates. Let's say beta is equal to 0.01. In that case, J0 of beta is equal to 1, J1 of beta is equal to beta by 2, and Jn of beta is approximately equal to 0 for n greater than or equal to 0. What does that mean? It means that whenever when your modulation index beta is small, out of all small, then you recall from your series x of t equal to sigma n is equal to minus infinity to plus infinity a times jn of beta cos of n, sorry, omega c plus n omega m times t. See, this has infinite number of terms, this series, right? So out of this infinite number of terms, from this expression only 3 terms are significant if beta is much less than 1. What are those 3 terms? J0 of beta times cos omega ct, then J1 of beta times, of course A will multiply here, A will precede, J1 of beta times cos of omega c plus omega mt, and A times J suffix minus 1 of, sorry, beta times cos of omega c minus omega m times t. Remaining all other terms are significant, all other terms are regarded, why disregarded, why? Because that will be approximately equal to 0, 0 and anything 0. Therefore, whenever beta is much less than 1, in that case 3 terms are significant, because J naught of beta is non-zero, J1 of beta is not equal to 0, J minus 1 of beta is not equal to 0, this is plus beta. What about J2 of beta? J2 of beta is equal to 0 if beta is much less than 1. Therefore, in this infinite number of terms, we need to consider only 3 terms. Okay, one corresponding to n equals 0, one corresponding to n equals 1, and the other corresponding to n equals minus 1. That's all. That means the spectral components that you will see will be primarily the carrier frequency. This one carrier frequency that you will see, and then when n equals 1, you will get this component omega c plus omega m. When n equals minus 1, you will get this component omega c minus omega m, which is very interesting, because precisely these spectral components which are present in the AM signal. AM signal also we have the same thing, A times cos of omega c t, then A times let's say AM times cos of omega c plus omega m times t divided by 2, then AM by 2 cos of omega c minus omega m times t. So these 3 components present in the AM also, and these 3 components, same 3 components present in the FM also, but there is small minor change that we will discuss later on. Okay, here the coefficients are same. Look at here, in omega c plus omega m, omega c plus omega m, what is the coefficient? AC by AM by 2. For omega c minus omega m, again the coefficients are same, but here the coefficients are J1 of beta and J minus 1 of beta. Okay, so A times J1 of beta and A times J minus 1 of beta. Now, are they equal? No, we said it is, they are not equal. This will be equal to minus of that. Okay, in fact, if you want to write for FM, this is A times J naught of beta times cos omega ct, then A times J1 of beta times cos of omega c plus omega m times t, then minus A times J suffix minus 1 of beta cos of omega c minus omega mt. Okay, so notice the difference. Here the coefficient is A1 J1 of beta. Here the coefficient is minus, there is a minus symbol. This is for fm. When beta is much, much less than 1. But in the AM case, this is my upper sideband and this is my lower sideband. Both upper sideband and the lower sideband has the same value, AC AM by 2, AC AM by 2. But here, this is my upper sideband. Upper sideband has the value of A times J1 of beta, and this is the lower sideband. Lower sideband has the value of minus A times J minus 1 of beta. So there is additional minus 180 degree phase shift. So that is the difference between narrow band. So I'm sorry, if beta is less than 1, that then this FM is called narrow band FM. Narrow band FM signal. So therefore that is a minor difference between narrow band FM and AM. So this is called a narrow band angle modulation. When will you call narrow band angle modulation? If beta is much less than 1. Your modulation index, whenever it is much less than 1, then that will become narrow band angle modulation. Anyway, I will discuss this little later. Now we are discussing Bessel function, right? So let us continue this Bessel function properties. We will come back to this point separately again. Then lastly, the fourth point is, maybe a couple of other properties are there, but that is not of any immediate practical or physical relevance to our course. But one important interesting mathematical property that Bessel function satisfies is called iterative relationship. Okay, that they have here with respect to each other. Some recursive relationship. What it says is, Bessel functions of different orders satisfy recursion, because no need to remember all the values. Okay, what is the value of J0, beta, J1, J2, J3, like that. Once you know two consecutive values, then you can construct the third value. So that's called iterative relationship. So Jn minus 1 of beta plus Jn 1 n plus 1 of beta is equal to 2n by beta times, where did I stop? It's here. Yeah. J suffix n minus 1 of beta plus draw J suffix n plus 1 of beta is equal to 2n by beta plus Jn of beta. So it essentially tells us that if I know Jn of beta and J suffix n minus 1 of beta, then I can, for a given value of beta, then I can find out J suffix n plus 1 of beta. That's what it means. So there is a recursive relationship that is satisfied by the Bessel function, and this is helpful in the computation of the Bessel functions. This we will not use much, okay? So just for the completeness, I have given this. But still, I think with the help of these properties, you get some idea, but not the complete idea about what the Bessel functions actually look like. So it will be interesting to, interesting to plot some of these functions, okay? J0 of beta, J1 of beta, etc., and see that, see what they look like. So you will see, start feeling better about these functions, okay? So just to hold on 1 minute, let me draw this plot. Maybe I can, it is in my mail. Let me plot meanwhile. This x-axis is beta and this y axis is your Bessel function. For j naught of beta, it keep on goes like this, and j1 of beta like this, and j2 of beta like this. Let me use different colors so that it will be much better. Fine. This is j0 of beta. Okay. And then let me use this color. J1 of beta is like this. Maybe like this. And J3 of beta like this. This is J2 of beta, and this one is J1 of beta. This is my Bessel function. Okay, so this is a plot, it looks like. So I have plotted here J0 of beta as a function of beta, and J1 of beta as a function of beta, and J3 of beta as a function of beta. And similarly, you can plot more also. Now, what do you see from these plots? You see that this function is oscillatory. First point is it is oscillatory, oscillatory in nature. They are not monotonically increasing or decreasing. Okay, either not increasing nor decreasing. Okay, neither increasing nor decreasing. I'm sorry, neither monotonically increasing nor monotonically decreasing. That's what I mean by. They are oscillatory in nature. Okay, it is not exactly an oscillation of constant amplitude like your output from the oscillator. The amplitude decreases as beta increases. See, the amplitude keep on, if you take this curve, the amplitude keep on decreases as you go along the beta curve. As beta becomes very, very large, they all become very small. If you keep on go, then it oscillates like this, very small oscillations. Okay, that is the first property. Then the second property that we discussed was J naught of beta. This is when beta is equal to 0, the maximum value will be 1. Okay, so this point is 1 at this point. Please hold on 1 second. Okay. It is oscillatory in nature. When beta equals 0, then as per our property, beta equals 0 means what? It is much, much less than 1, right? So therefore, this is equal to 1 as per our first property. And that occurs in this point, in the neighborhood of the 0. It is exactly equal to 1. And all other functions, J1 of beta starts from, see, it starts from like this. It is nowhere close to 1. And J2 of beta, still it is very less. Let me change the color. In this region, it is almost linear. Okay, it looks like a linear. Okay, approximately increases linearly in this point. Increases linearly. J1 of beta increases linearly
when beta is less than 1 or close to 0. Okay, whereas this curve, okay, J1 of beta is almost 0, not even linearly increasing. Okay, so this curve is not evenly linearly increasing. Because in the, you know, it is not like live classroom, so it is taking much time. Okay, therefore this curve is more or less 0 when, see, it goes like this. Start, look at the starting point, this point. Let me enlarge. Look at this region. It is almost 0, and after that it's slowly increasing. Therefore, when beta is close to 0, this guy is J2 of beta is 0, almost 0, approximately. That's what the property that we discussed. If you look at the curve, then you'll get it. One second, let me know whether I have this plot. Okay, sent this one. Okay, save it. Insert pictures. That's it. Now done. Now you look at the, so this is the Bessel functions. See, now it is very nice to explain. You look at J2 of beta, it is slowly increasing here. So when beta is close to 0, in that case your J2 of beta approximately equal to 0, that's why it is increasing like this. Your J0 of beta is coming like this. Like this it goes. So all the properties are just I have mentioned to you can be seen to be true from this plot. And because this function is oscillatory in nature, the spectrum varies a lot. Okay, for example, let's look at J0 of beta, this one, J0 of beta. For small values of beta, the carrier component is the largest value, see, maximum value. And there is of course the first sideband components is omega c plus or minus omega m will occur. Okay, but suppose the modulation index is somewhere here. Okay, let's say in this point modulation indexes where beta is equal to something 2.4 or something. For this value, what happens to J0 of beta? It becomes 0. So for a particular modulation index, like when beta is equal to 2.4, then your J0 of beta is equal to 0. That means what? It exists only the carrier. That means your carrier component becomes 0, right? When n equals 0, this J0 of beta is 0. So in this point, your J0 of beta is 0, and then again it comes and crosses this point. Then maybe use a different color. This point again comes, this point, then goes and comes back, this point, then again comes over, and this point. In these points, your carrier component will be 0. This point is roughly 2.4. Okay, carrier, because if this J0 of 0 is 0, J0 of beta is 0, then because this is multiplied by cos omega ct, your carrier component. If this guy becomes 0, then carrier component also will be 0. Okay, that is the coefficient of the carrier component. J0 of beta is the coefficient of the carrier component. So this becomes 0 when beta takes the value such that this J0 of beta is 0. And this will be something 5 point something, okay, 5 point something, and this one is 8 point something, like that. So at this values the carrier component disappears, and you have all the energy present in the side bands only. Okay, so I think that's it about the properties of the Bessel function. Then in the next lecture let us talk about the spectrum, okay, I mean bandwidth of the FM signal. Okay, spectrum of wide band angle modulation, how much bandwidth it needs, and then we will discuss spectral properties. What are the properties does it have? And then we will calculate bandwidth of angle modulated signal. Okay, so let me stop. Thank you very much.